Saludamos especialmente a los estudiantes, profesores, amigos de la Facultad de Psicología de la Universidad Diego Portales. Estamos el día de hoy, esta tarde, reunidos para poder escuchar la conferencia de la profesora Valerie Valkerdine. Para la Facultad de Psicología es en verdad una gran alegría y un gran honor poder contar con la presencia de Valerie. Ella es profesora en la Escuela de Ciencias Sociales de la Universidad de Cardiff, en Gales, y es una de las psicólogas críticas e investigadoras más importantes en el campo de los estudios psicosociales, estudios sobre la psicología, sobre la subjetividad, sobre el desarrollo de la psicología crítica en Inglaterra y desde Inglaterra y el Reino Unido. Ha sido una figura fundamental desde fines de los años 70, 80, 90 en el desarrollo de este campo, una larga trayectoria de la psicología crítica, los abordajes psicosociales sobre la subjetividad y sobre todo un aporte fundamental desde la psicología en pensar las articulaciones entre la subjetividad y los procesos sociales, los procesos históricos, las estructuras sociales, articulando una mirada interdisciplinar que incorpora dimensiones de clase, de género, de etnia, de territorialidad. Y en lo que respecta a algunos de sus últimos líneas de trabajo, más específicamente en la relación de lo que tiene que ver la producción de subjetividades en el contexto del neoliberalismo y de las transformaciones del mundo del trabajo en el Reino Unido, pero siempre con una perspectiva también global. Así que simplemente agradecer su presencia acá para la facultad, reitero, es un motivo de alegría y orgullo contar con tu presencia, Valerie, agradecer tu generosidad para compartir tu trabajo en esta instancia, que también marca un poco el inicio del año académico de nuestra facultad. Así que, sin más, le voy a dar la palabra a Valerie. La idea es tener una conferencia de alrededor de 50 minutos, un poco más, un poco menos, y después tendremos un espacio de preguntas y diálogo. Valerie, termino comentando, está recorriendo distintas universidades en América Latina en un esfuerzo y proyecto de articular una red de investigación sobre temas de precariedad, neoliberalismo, subjetividades laborales. Y aquí en Chile estamos dialogando la facultad y también el equipo de la profesora Isabel Piper en la Universidad de Chile y está haciendo este recorrido, así que esperamos que esto sea solo el comienzo de una historia y de un proceso de trabajo colaborativo y de intercambio académico con Valerie y la Universidad de Cardiff que se prolongue para más adelante. Así que muchas gracias, Valerie, y te doy la palabra.
Hola, estoy muy contenta de estar aquí con ustedes para hablar de neoliberalismo, trabajo y subjetividad. Muchas gracias a Antonio por eso. And now I'm going to speak in English. Porque si tratía de hablar más, puede estar más Spanglish que español. talking about neoliberalism in what is one of the longest neoliberalized countries in the world presents an interesting set of issues for us to think about. In the past, as some of you may know, I've written about the specificity of responses to neoliberal governance in two countries, Australia and Wales. in that work, published in 2007, a whole decade ago now, the UK had started to engage with neoliberalism a decade earlier still than that. So, for example, we see Nicholas Rose on the slide here, writing in 1999 his book, The Powers of Freedom, where, so that was the time when he argued, as we have on the slide, that the imperative to be free within liberalism has been developed so that we live as if we were in furtherance of what he called a biographical project of self-realization. So this sense of the imperative to be free, to organize ourselves, to be in charge of our own biographies and trajectories, really then started to speak about what was happening in the UK at that time. Suggesting that the global effects of neoliberal governance practices and technologies can't be determined in any one place or time is where I ended up in 2007. Because when I looked at that work from Nicholas Rose and I thought about what was emerging in research on work in Australia and Wales, two quite different sites, actually, one in Sydney and one in a community in South Wales that had previously had a steel industry. Then we started to see that the practices, the neoliberal governance practices and technologies, can't be simply determined in any one place or time. That the idea that governance works in the same way all over the place seemed to us to be needing some more complexity. So we concluded that it was necessary to think about the global through the complex interconnections of the local. In Bruno Latour's sense, we can't know the path that the production of knowledge will take. But more than this, we can't know in advance patterns of subjection and self-production, nor can we know the affective resonances, histories, and relations that make up our daily lives. So Rose's idea that the practice of freedom through which we have to define a biographical project of our life, to shape it into an unique trajectory in which psychology plays a particular part by defining the particular characteristics of success, for example, aspiration, a certain kind of personality, and so forth, is itself, I want to argue, not completely determining of subjection or subjectification. Certainly, of course, it forms a central plank of the technologies and practices of governance. The parameters of consumption. We can see that all around us. We can see it here just as we can see it in places like the UK. But it cannot ever, and this is what I want to particularly argue and go beyond really, cannot ever totally determine and control despite appeals to a microphysics of power. And it's that I particularly want to talk about today. So I want to think about the challenges in relation to how to think about the uses and the issues and the specificities of neoliberal subjectivities, written in particular times and places. So what does it mean to produce a neoliberal subject in 2017 in Chile, in Wales, in Australia, for example? Are they the same? I don't think they are the same. I think they will share some aspects, but they will not be totally similar. So it's how we think about that, both similarity and difference across time and space and across territories, that I want to think about, as well as thinking about the issues of change, the possibilities of subjective change. So I want to think about these challenges in relation to these particular places, as I've said, by referring to the specific history of research that I have undertaken in the period following 1997, that is the last 20 years. I should also add that 1997 was the year in the UK that Wales, Scotland and Northern Ireland gained their own governments. So it's a very significant year. So we're 20 years since that period. And of course, I'm also going to discuss how we get to Brexit and beyond Brexit. Because although we had, you know, we could find neoliberalism across that whole period, nobody in power was expecting Brexit, as I'm sure you have read. And so how in that 20 years have we moved across there to there? And what does it mean? How do we understand that in relation to these challenges of thinking about both global and local and the possibility of change? Okay. A little aside, one of the things that's been appearing recently in the newspapers in the UK is and some investigative journalism that has been showing that companies were employed to do various kinds of data mining from social media, based on PSYOPs techniques, psychological operations in warfare. And so I think there's also another chapter for us to start thinking about in relation to the role of psychology, which I hadn't even begun to think about before. So we've moved into something that attempts to target complex sentiments and affects through social media, and also what people are calling post-truth, although I'm quite critical of that idea. But I just put that as an aside. I haven't had a chance to think any more about it, but I think it allows us also to think about, as I say, the place of psychology and how that changes also and emerges in relation to practices of governance. Okay, so I want to begin with a film. Some of you may have heard of a film, a British film, made in 1997, so precisely that year, called The Full Monty. Some people do know it, obviously. Well, I'm just going to show you a little clip of it, just the beginning of the film. And Antonio's found us a version with Spanish subtitles. The film is set in Sheffield. Sheffield is a town in the UK, in the north of the UK, which was famous for steel production. And especially in the 1960s, but by 1997, we're seeing layoffs, unemployment, and closure. So the crisis for working class men in particular was what to do beyond heavy industrial work. We're presented in the film with this crisis and its resolution in a humorous way. But I very much like the film because I think it shows all kinds of aspects about industrial masculinity, what happens to masculinity, how the change to the gender division of labour is produced. In fact, we won't go this far in the film, but as we'll get to see these working class unemployed men who feel they're not worth anything and not attractive are led by seeing women going to see male strippers in a club to themselves become a group of male strippers. It is very funny. But it also shows us that transformation of masculinity into objects of sexual of sexual interest and consumption. Let's just have a look at the beginning. I think you know, it shows this sense of an industrial and economic miracle, then of course what happens when the British government, in line with many other governments, decides to move to from manufacturing to finance capital. Therefore then what happens in these kinds of towns. So it contains, albeit humorously, the many of the elements that defined what happened in industrial cities all over the UK, and especially in South Wales. South Wales was a major producer of coal, iron and steel. As you know, all of that also collapsed. So we see very similar kinds of conditions. Okay, so there's a loss of industry, a loss of sense of historical masculinity, industrial, a sense of the loss of heavy industry and the masculinity that accompanies that. You begin to see that in the Full Monty, that what does it mean to be a man in the context in which you can no longer do work, heavy work, with the body. In particular, for the people that I worked with, dirty work, work that makes you feel tired at the end of the day. When that's gone, what do you do? Despair, poverty, changes to the gender division of labour, change to the body, to sexuality and consumption. And if we follow Foucault, the need to refashion oneself as a work of art. That is, and I think that relates to what Nicholas Rose called the biographical project of the self. So here we've got a whole sense of the possibility of transformation into not only a neoliberal subject, but a particular kind of changed masculinity and a particular changed set of gender relations. They move to practices of consumption, the need to rethink relations between women and men. But what the film also shows is a crisis for specific industrial communities. For a particular class in Britain, the industrial working class, and the difficulties associated with loss, trauma, and change. In the early, in the mid part of the 2000s, I worked in one such community, an ex-steel town in Wales. Not quite like Sheffield, they made a different kind of steel, but it was a small town at the what's called the head of a long valley, and at the heart of it, in the middle of the town, was the steelworks. I want to briefly discuss that work and to go on to talk about what's happened most recently, in fact, in the last few weeks, since I've been in Latin America, actually. So the historical process of the production of iron and steel lasted 200 years up until 2002. But during that time, there was certainly not stability. You know, if we imagine an industrial era in which, identities, subjectivities, and modes of living were stable, this is not the case. My historical and archival work brought to light the fact that there were many attempts in the past to close the works at different historical moments. There was also a constant fluctuation in the price of iron and steel on the global market. Thus, if the price of iron and steel went up, it made one kind of implication for the number of workers and the amount of steel produced. If it went down, obviously, the workforce had to change. So far from there being a sense of stability, there was a sense of what I came to call chronic insecurity. And I want to stress this. That sense of an unstable moment, the sense that you can, in fact, even then, even when there is industry, not exactly know what's going to happen, creates, I think, a response to that instability. And the threat of poverty and things falling apart. So, I want to suggest, and I've put it on points here on the slide, that certain kinds of things emerge from that. And this emerges from interviews and ethnographic work with people in the town in the few years following the closure. The first and most important thing, which we've seen also in the Full Monty, is what I would call heavy industrial masculinity. That is a masculinity in which strength of the body to do difficult, dangerous, and dirty work is most important. There's a strong gender division of labour. Many men talk about the distance from femininity. Women had a particular job that was often to look after the family, sometimes to look after the money. The men would bring their wages home. Sometimes also women would read things. There was certainly still existing in the mid-2000s a sense amongst many men that they did not want to learn to read, that reading was a feminine activity. that the body that you honed was a body that did labor. So, I want to stress this distance from femininity because femininity itself then had to be seen as very, very different. And in fact, what I came to understand was that femininity acted as a kind of threat to the possibility of being hard. You cannot withstand, you cannot hone the body to withstand danger and constant difficulty if, in your senses, you are weak and emotional. I'm not saying that's what femininity is, I'm talking about, okay? But that sense of what I'm trying to talk about is the production of certain kinds of tropes and subjectivities. There was a family-like organization of mutual aid. Many, many, many people used the metaphor of a family to talk about the town. The town was like one big family. And at first I thought that was a kind of nostalgia, but I came to understand that actually what it defined was practices of mutual aid, which acted in a familial way. That is, people looked after each other's children. They helped out when somebody had a crisis. So there was a very well-developed, family-like set of practices for mutual support. And fourthly, there was the absence of individualism and aspiration. Now, again, this is particularly important when we think about neoliberalism. There was, excuse me, I'll have a drop more water. There was a sense that nobody should stand out or think about themselves as better than anybody else. What you had to do was pull together, was work together, because only by working together, producing this kind of mutual support and also strong trade unions, would people be able to manage this chronic insecurity? That's my main argument. So, I mention the individualism and aspiration particularly because, as we know, neoliberalism particularly stresses that sense, as Rose is saying, of a biographical project of the self. It's a self who aspires, who has some sense of wanting to be something. That was not only totally absent in people's accounts, but it was really frowned on because it disrupted solidarity. Okay. So we understand the production of what I call affective practices. These are practices through which affective relations of support are transmitted. So, for example, the mutual support, the family, you know, the different kinds of ways of being. But in addition, I think, these keep away what I have called the spectre of annihilation. Now, what I mean here is not that necessarily anybody thought they were going to be killed, although, of course, industrial accidents were quite common, as was disease and lack of food from poverty. But what I'm trying to talk about here is more a sense of the threat posed by insecurity and the sense to produce the possibility of going on being. what I've called here forming a thick skin. So going on being produced through collective effort, strong trade unions, and the need to understand the specific forms and practices of existence that are formed in particular locations and particular circumstances. In this context, it's about effective practices of holding the community together, continuing to be, continuing to exist, ontological security, however we want to frame that. In the book that Luis Jimenez and I wrote about it, there's a lot of detail about how to understand this experience, especially my use of notions of necessary defensive organization to ward off the threats of annihilation. But I haven't got time to talk about that here in detail. But that I will just mention that there was what I called a protective skin, a thick skin, what psychoanalysts have called a second skin, that keeps the community safe in relation to these hostile threats. So, for example, people talked about you would never share your problems in public with other people. You just would not talk about it. People have their own problems. You don't want to make their problems more difficult by sharing your problems. You keep talk of your problems inside the family. You look after your own in the community. You do not move for work because in other places, they look after their own people. So we look after our own people here. We make sure that the young men can go into steelwork. We support them. We support the families. But we stay tightly knit. This not moving for work also produces a sense of distrust of outsiders. So you don't go out, but there's an issue about people coming in. And I want you to remember that also in relation to Brexit. So when the works closes in 2002, the site, remember this is in the middle of the town, is bulldozed within 1 month of closure. So the town is left with this absolutely enormous empty flat space. It's difficult to overemphasize the effect of this on the patterns of relationality in the town. There are no sounds of people walking to work. There's no whistles blowing. There's no fire coming out of chimneys. Everything is silenced. So if ways of being depend upon responses to that specificity, then the enforced change is hugely threatening to the possibility of continuing to be, to go on being. So if all of the things I've talked about are formed within and take a long time to form, obviously, within 200 years, and then are suddenly gone, that what people start to experience and talk about is the loss of all those things and the difficulty of understanding what to do in their absence. The trade union had a response. They said that people should build new careers based on interests, and they did pay for some retraining. Again, I can't go into that in great detail, but One of the things I do particularly want to mention is that during this time, women began to talk about how they had to hold a sense of masculinity for the men, so that the men were no longer what we call in English breadwinners. They weren't winning any bread, but the women felt, many of them talked about the feeling that they had to stop their men falling apart. There was quite a lot of illness, physical and psychological illnesses, as you might imagine. They had to hold on to things. They had to keep working. They had to find work, even when their men were not working. And they had to, this comes out in many different ways, bolster a sense that the men were still men. And so they often described them as breadwinners still. So that also was quite, I'm very interested in that sense that although something, a gender division of labour is enforced, a change in work is enforced, relatively high wages have gone. Men and women in families both have to work. All of those things have changed. But nevertheless, at an engagement with subjectivity, all kinds of complex things are happening between the women and the men to attempt to, as it were, keep something going that's already gone. And it's not only the women doing this. There's also intergenerational issues. Young men reported great difficulties when they tried to access the new forms of work. Most of those forms of work were low-skilled work, usually presented by them as feminine. So, for example, contract cleaning, pizza delivery, stacking shelves in a supermarket. And there are a lot of reports of transgenerational problems. So women contract cleaners calling a young cleaner, a male cleaner, Mrs. Mop, a very derogatory term for a cleaner. Another young man who's delivering pizzas, his father's friends stop talking to the father because they think it's so shameful that this young man is delivering pizzas and is wearing the uniform of a pizza delivery boy and not the clothes of a manual worker. Other young men talk about trying to stack shelves in a supermarket and their friends coming in and messing up the shelves that they've stacked. So you can see the complex intergenerational and within generation difficulties that emerge specifically related to this change in the kind of work and the gender division of labour. So, given that that's what was happening in the mid-2000s, how does change happen? For some, things fall apart. They can't change or respond and develop ways of being on benefits. There is, has been well documented in these places, a rise in drugs. Many people will still stay close to home, even if there are no jobs. Or people, young people going away and not coming back. There are no good wages. Women and men must work, and levels of poverty increase dramatically. There is a loss of amenities in the community. Shops close down. All those kinds of things disappear because people don't have enough money to consume. So in the middle of a miracle of consumption, we have people who cannot consume, who don't have shops in which they can consume, barely have enough money to survive. That was 10 years ago. So communities had to adapt in quite complex ways. There was a loss of benefits, welfare. I don't know whether people know this about the UK, but the Conservative government hugely changed, well, and the Labour government before it actually, hugely changed the benefits system and the welfare payments. So it became quite very, very much more difficult to access benefits. I don't know whether the film I, Daniel Blake has come to Chile. It's a film by a filmmaker called Ken Loach. If it comes here, it's a very interesting film about what happens to an ex-carpenter trying to claim benefits and while he's out of work. But also, the loss of jobs means what we call in the UK zero-hours contracts. Zero-hours contracts are contracts in which you get a contract with a company, let's say a supermarket, but you don't have a specific number of hours. The supermarket can call you into work anytime or not call you in. You don't know when you will get work. But if you're not available for work, they may not call you again. That zero-hours contracts have become very, very common in the UK. There's an increase in food banks, huge, huge increase in food banks. Food banks are places where you can go to get free food. People donate food. Massive increase across the whole of the UK in use of food banks. And then people have to create, of course, this is where they begin to be forced into entrepreneurialism, because they do create self-employment. So, for example, it's quite common now for men who are working to work in London, on a building site in London. London is experiencing a massive boom in building. So I discovered that men are travelling together in cars. They go to London for the week. They live in caravans on the building site. And then they come home for the weekend if they've got work. Or they set themselves up as delivery drivers for Amazon. All of these multinational companies employ self-employed workers who are not entitled to anything. So they set themselves up as delivery drivers with, again, quite difficult conditions, other forms of making a living. So that whole sense of entrepreneurial subjectivity that we associate with neoliberalism is there. Attempts by the government, the Welsh government, I'm talking about here, but it's also true of the UK government, use both a carrot and a stick. they attempt to create aspiration. They cut benefits. They give specific mental health support in job centres. And they create conditions in which people have to accept work. But as I've tried to show, this sense of... So I want to then come back to this issue of the specific masculinity. So many young men, as I said, did not... older men and younger men did not want to learn to read. That's still the case. So levels of attainment, especially amongst boys, is very poor. What they want is work that's not available. If they get work, then it's very low paid. So this sense of an opposition to standing out and aspiration is still quite central to these communities. And as you can imagine, there develops a huge resentment and mistrust of government, any government, any form of government, the Westminster government, the Welsh government, the European Union government. It doesn't matter which government, because all of them feel like government. In fact, when I spoke recently to people in this town, one of the things, after Brexit, one of the things that they talked about was that, oh, yes, of course the European Union brought a road. That's great if you want to drive from Birmingham to Swansea, but it's 20 years too late for us and it doesn't come to this town. Yes, the European Union gave money to support a new hospital, but two other hospitals were closed and we now have less hospital beds than before. Yes, they produced, helped to create a new school, but we had a better school before and nobody wants to go to this school, etc., etc., etc. In fact, the thing that people talked about most was a Welsh dragon. I don't know whether you know that the symbol of Wales is a red dragon. And the European Union funds paid for a very large metal red dragon to be put in the town. The hatred of that dragon has to be heard to be believed, because, you know, people are suffering in poverty. The last thing they wanted was things that they didn't want. So, of course, this was clearly not understood within a metropolitan elite, that actually, because everybody kept saying, but, you know, these people benefited from the European Union, but they don't feel they benefited at all. Moreover, they felt that nobody listened to them. Nobody was listening. This was said before Brexit again and again. Nobody listens. Nobody hears us. What they wanted was jobs. It's all anybody will talk about, jobs. They want jobs. They don't want 0 hours contracts. They want proper jobs, not they want apprenticeships. They want manufacturing. I want then to... I don't know how I'm doing for time, Antonia. I've completely lost a sense of the time. Have
it's
I,
okay. 10 minutes
more. Great, great. Thank you. So, really, what I'm trying to express to you is that although we have modes of neoliberal governance within this situation, within the UK... In this particular place, and of course it's different in different parts of the UK, it's not the same in London as it is in South Wales, for example. But here, the response to neoliberalism, as I've tried to show, is quite complex and is not an automatic uptake of the sense that one has to have a biographical project of the self. That's what I'm trying to say. Therefore, we need to understand precisely those specificities within countries and between countries. If we talk about what's happening here in Chile, it will not be the same as what's happening in South Wales, I don't expect, because neoliberalism started at a different moment, took a different form, etc., etc. But what I am trying to say is that as psychologists and social scientists, we need to understand the specificity of historical circumstances in which neoliberalism emerges, the engagements with it, the results of it, and what happened, and the unpredictability of its path. If nobody in a metropolitan elite in Britain predicted Brexit, then what else do we not know? I could have predicted Brexit, but then that's because I knew how desperate everybody was feeling and how angry. So we cannot know, this is what I also want to say, that we cannot know, it's not entirely controllable, a path that something will take. And we need to understand the specificity of relationalities, affects, discourses, practices, modes of governance through which all this happens and through which, therefore, change is possible. So, I did some more recent research, which I called co-produced research. Co-produced research. Thank you. Sorry, I'm not very good with remembering to move the slides on. Apologies. Co-produced research works on an agenda together with people. So traditional academic research, of course, defines what the goal of the research is and carries it out. This kind of research is not only participatory, I think it goes beyond participatory action research because it actually works together with the people you're researching with to create the agenda and the mode of doing the research. So what we were working on, what they wanted to work on, was how to achieve self-determination. This is in the same community. People, as I say, were really clear what they wanted. Despite all the pressure, they wanted industry, jobs. So, the attempt to impose an agenda failed, really. Well, failed except for some of the right-wing conservatives who particularly did want Brexit and wanted to turn Britain into a finance capital. So, I mean, it did work in that sense. And that's why I think it's important to look at what I mentioned earlier about psyops and the modes of working with affect in the present. But I want to say that the sense of what these people wanted and which I worked with them also to present to the Welsh government. They met the Welsh government and presented their ideas. I must say the Welsh government didn't respond very well. They said, well, Forget that then, don't worry about that. We didn't expect them to listen, and I'll tell you what happens next in a minute. But I want to reject an approach via ideology. These were not people who were deceived or duped. I don't think they read the post-truths. Many of them couldn't read. Yes, the agenda they chose is a path that plays into the hands of wealthy global elites who want to make Britain a tax haven. But even then, the story continues. So, May 2017, we saw local government elections across the UK. In those elections, some of the people from this ex-steel community decided that they were going to stand as independents for control of the county council. This is the, it's bigger than a town, so it's a quite a large local area. They didn't want to align themselves with any political party that existed because they didn't trust any of the political parties to deliver their agenda. They stood for the council elections and they won. They said they would win, they told me they would win, and they won. And I was already in Latin America when this happened, so I haven't had a chance to talk to them about it. But they did say to me beforehand that they would win, and then maybe the Welsh government would have to listen. Well, we will see what happens, but I think this is a very interesting development, which also mirrors what we're seeing in many countries about the distrust of mainstream parties and so forth, and therefore the desire to produce self-governance through and self-determination through a different kind of agenda. I think it's extremely confused, but these are important and early days. Some people have called this flat pack or DIY democracy. Flat pack is the way you buy furniture that you have to assemble yourself. That's called a flat pack. Some people have called that flat pack democracy or DIY democracy. So to finish, I'm suggesting that an understanding of specificity, history, location, etc., is absolutely central for us to understand neoliberalism, work and subjectivity. Secondly, that an analysis of patterns of relationality through mapping of effective histories, effective practices, ways of being and ways of being together are also central. Though an attempt to produce an individual is enforced, it's not so straightforward. So how does it work? How can we think about it? So I'm inviting us to think differently about it in a more complex way. Also, of course, we need to understand the discourses and practices of governance and how those are inhabited. Again, as we've seen, in quite complex ways that will differ in different places. And I think just again, as an aside about Brexit, what you see is, and I contrasted South Wales and London, but what you see in London is a very different kind of work, a different workforce, a different engagement, a much more sense of being metropolitan, a more sense of an engagement with the global and so forth. So again, one needs to understand the specificity both at a discursive and an effective level. I want to ask, how is beingness the way of being produced together through relationalities in common. We saw what they were before Brexit, and we're beginning to see some kind of transformation. But what does that look like? How do we understand it? What effective pathways are there? What small perceptions, sensations, flows? What patterns of defensive organization and shoring up of being together? How is enforced change lived? And what is produced? What actions of sociality therefore produce the possibility of self-determination? So, as I say, I've only given one case. There are many others. But I'm here in Latin America working with Antonio and colleagues and colleagues in other countries in order to produce a network where we can develop together across countries and sites methodological and theoretical ways forward to understand specificity and transformation and the production of subjectivity and work in this both global and local moment. Thank you very much.
Muchas gracias, Valerie. Tenemos ahora entonces un tiempo para preguntas, comentarios y para abrir la conversación. Hay un micrófono.
Translators that I probably can understand. I'll try and understand the questions if people talk slowly. However you like.
Bien, se ofrece entonces la palabra para preguntas, comentarios, quizás juntar un grupo primero de cuatro preguntas, tres, cuatro, para que de ahí Valerie pueda comentar, responder. Gino ofrece el...
Hi. Thank you for your presentation.
Hi.
I was just wondering if you can talk about what you mean with self-determination and subjectivity and how these two relate.
Okay.
Do you want to take a number of questions?
Just three of them.
Yeah.
First, then we'll answer to that. Allá, Gino, Mónica.
En español. I've been wondering what you said about the differences between girls and boys related with the reading. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's just a detail of your research or something, a very subtle interpretation you made, but I'd love if you can go deeper with that, please. Thank you.
En español. It's not a bad English. Me gustaría que pudiera entregar algunos ejemplos similares al Zero Hours Contract como ejemplos de patrones de subjection, patterns of subjection, modalidades expressions, ejemplos de patterns of subjection. Y también consultar respecto a las posibilidades de los esfuerzos colectivos como una manera de enfrentar estos patrones de subjection.
Thank you for the thoughtful and inquisitive talk. So it seemed to me that there was some sort of a divide world between the big cities and these smaller towns. It was being very, it was resonating to me because I lived in the US Midwest for a while, and you could even find these food deserts, you know, places where there was no money and there was no food. Like, the only thing you could buy was some potato chips and stuff like that. But there was this absolute not recognition from the city to these other realities. I mean, I found those food deserts just by accident. Nobody knew that they even existed. So do you think there is some sort of like divided world between what you can see in London, for example, or Chicago or something like that, and what you would see in smaller cities or smaller towns? Thank you.
Shall I deal with all this? I can't just move my nose. Okay, well, I'll try and engage with those very interesting issues. The first speaker asked me to talk about self-determination and subjectivity. Okay, this is something which I'm only just beginning to work on. So, but I want to relate it actually to the question of the third speaker about possibilities of collective effort dealing with these patterns, because one of the things that I've started to think about is the way in which strategies of engagement through work, so for example, trade union organization would be a classic one, no longer work in these places because they're people on 0 hours contracts cannot, are not forming trade unions, are not together for any length of time, et cetera, all kinds of reasons why collective action can't happen that way. And that's one of the reasons why I'm very interested in what happened in these local elections, because I think that what we're beginning to see is people working together at the in the context of location. We could call it community if we wanted to, but you know, people working together because they are sharing things. That this is why I think that the issue about what happened in Steeltown when people were trying to support each other is important to think about here. So it wasn't simply that the steelworks had a strong trade union. It's that patterns of mutual aid and support were terribly important to survival. Now, those patterns of mutual aid and support have been terribly threatened by the things that I've described. But nevertheless, the basis for the possibility of self-determination seems to me to be there within that. That's what the people in this ex-steel community drew on. That is, we can't do it through work. We can't support a political party, no matter how traditionally working class that party has been, because they don't support us, they can't hear us. Therefore, we're going to do it ourselves. I think that there's something in that, but I haven't actually, I've only just started to think about that. So I can't say I've done masses of research on it. But I have also been doing some work with one of my colleagues in another community, quite different from the ex-steel community, which is in a quite wealthy market town, but it's a public housing estate on the edge of the town, where people did vote in very large numbers for Brexit, have very low levels of literacy and very high levels of poverty. And it also appears to be the case that they also have, ways of mutual support, as one would expect. Even though those are challenged, nevertheless, they do have a mutual support. One of the things that they said was that their voting for Brexit was entirely about people talking to each other. They voted Brexit because their neighbours voted Brexit, and they voted Brexit because their neighbours voted Brexit. It's not that they were, reading lots of stuff, because, as I say, many of them didn't have very high levels of literacy. So I'm interested, really, in going back to this self-determination and subjectivity issue. I'm interested in how outside the formal aspects of technologies of governance, people also form themselves through relationalities that support or attempt to support the possibility of continuity of being together. And I have a feeling that that's where it might be possible also to look. Going on to girls and boys and reading, it wasn't a big focus of the research, but traditionally within Britain, boys have been said to be much less inclined to read. I don't know whether that's true here, but that's quite a strong empirical finding. But what I think hasn't been addressed is this specific history of modes of masculinity, which think about not reading as a good thing. Now, again, you see, I think in relation to self-determination, one has to work with these people. It is absolutely pointless bringing in masses of new schemes to teach reading if people do not, at some level, want to read, if they feel ashamed even of reading. So I'm making a plea for that very detailed work in this way, which understands both what I call the affective history, as well as the discursive history, and the patterns of support and practices that emerge. Only if we work alongside that, I think any intervention can only be possible if we work alongside that. And that's not what, certainly in Wales or Westminster, has been happening at all. And that is what I think produces a response that says nobody listens to us. Okay, so 0 hours contracts and patterns of subjection. Again, I have to tell you, I haven't done this research, so it's work that we need to do. It's definitely work that needs to be done. But I can tell you a little bit about how managing happens, but I think that realistically, I would just be speculating. I think it's a really important issue that you've raised, and we really need to do that work. The divide between big cities and smaller towns, yes. And what you said about food deserts, absolutely, absolutely. Is there a divided world between London and smaller towns? Yes, huge. But also there's a big divide between metropolitan centres and deindustrialised communities. The strongest support, strongest working class support for Brexit was in deindustrialised communities, not just small towns. Small towns have a different organisation. There was a lot of support for Brexit in many small towns, depending on the geographical location of the small town, actually. But there, you've got a different kind of organisation of work, lots of small businesses in some places, with a very marginalised, like the one, the market town I'm talking about, where you've actually got quite a lot of wealth with very traditional conservative voters and but marginalised, very poor communities. So you can't quite read it off like that. But yes, there's a hugely divided world. And as you were saying in relation to the States about food deserts, from outside it was not being seen. It just was not being seen. The numbers of, journalists before Brexit who ventured into these places, to find out what the natives were thinking, was very small in number. Then, of course, the metropolitan elites of all political parties, I think, were genuinely surprised. They really had not expected this. Do we have time for more questions?
Una última ronda de dos o tres preguntas para cerrar.
Hola, la voy a hacer en español. no me queda muy claro, o quizás sí, que lo que propones con la investigación es que cada país vaya analizando desde las especificidades de neoliberalismo histórico que han tenido. Y me surge una pregunta que es, quizás en otros sustentos teóricos más de nuevas materialidades, que es, ¿no hay un discurso o un patrón que sea común de neoliberalismo que estemos viendo? Y en base a eso, que si bien me gusta mucho el ver este tema del trabajo comunitario como algo bueno y positivo de cómo han ido saliendo adelante estas ciudades postindustriales, ¿no podríamos verlo también quizás como una producción también neoliberal de formar al otro y por ende tratar como de unirnos en estas ciudades como comunidad, viendo el Brexit, por ejemplo, como lo ven yo creo que los políticos más conservadores, que es como queremos cerrar las fronteras? Me surge eso como pregunta, como quizás también un producto de esta investigación en distintos países podría promover cuál es el discurso común que este neoliberalismo está instalando y produciendo en los distintos lugares.
Hola, la pregunta que quiero hacer tiene que ver con lo siguiente. Tú mencionaste que había en general en las comunidades harto analfabetismo, poca lectura, pero y de alguna manera algún probablemente no hay una herencia en términos de conciencia de clase, ¿verdad? Entre ellos, pero la pregunta es si estas personas que dieron el paso hacia ese compromiso político tienen, digamos, algún proyecto ideológico debajo que vaya un poco más allá de la mera sobrevivencia, ¿cierto? Imagino que sí, y si lo hay, me gustaría que nos pudieras contar un poco más al respecto. Gracias.
Hola, mi nombre es Carlos, yo soy dirigente sindical. Aquí en Chile pasó algo bien parecido, ¿eh? En el sur, ¿ya? Tenemos hartas cosas relacionadas con lo que usted aquí ha hablado. Mi pregunta es la siguiente, o sea, una pregunta que me he hecho siempre, yo como dirigente, ¿ya? Lo que usted ha explicado acá es respecto a los partidos políticos. Yo estoy decepcionado con los partidos políticos. Nosotros fuimos formados por partidos políticos, pero en este momento los dirigentes no queremos saber nada. Lo mismo que usted estaba comentando ahí con los trabajadores que le hicieron como la cruz, le dijeron no a los partidos tradicionales ahí en la ciudad.
Yeah.
Aquí está pasando exactamente lo mismo. Acá nosotros como dirigentes ya no pertenecemos a ningún partido político y representamos en mejor mayor las cosas y hemos logrado muchas cosas. Lo que yo quiero saber, lo que a mí me gustaría saber y que alguien me lo explicara, ¿en qué momento? Porque es bien parecida a la historia que estuvo contando usted con la historia de Chile, es bien parecida, sobre todo lo contemporáneo, se parece mucho. ¿En qué momento nuestros políticos se desconectaron con la gente, ¿ya? Y viven como en una burbuja. Viven en una burbuja y el cariño, lo que existía antes, ya no existe. O sea, uno lo veo, la gente está muy agresiva, los políticos acá en Chile no están ni ahí con las cosas que están sucediendo, y eso es la realidad. Yo vengo de una empresa que de repente me da vergüenza decirlo, pero aquí mucha gente se moviliza en locomoción, no sé. Yo soy del Transantiago, somos como los top 10 de la corrupción aquí en Chile. Entonces yo conozco bien el caso, yo he trabajado harto y conozco bien el tema. Entonces, eso yo quiero saber, ¿en qué momento se perdió ese cariño, se perdió esa pasión hacia los partidos políticos? Porque yo creo que la relación igual como en su país, o sea, es casi lo mismo, porque acá nosotros, yo creo que la mayoría de la gente, yo creo que nadie es político acá, pues, o sea, ya a nadie le gusta la política, yo disculpe que me alargue un poquito, pero es que primera vez que estoy participando, yo siempre participo, la UDP siempre me invita, siempre yo vengo aquí a las charlas, ¿sí? Por eso es que aprovecho estos momentos porque para mí son súper importantes, ¿ya? ¿En qué momento? Eso, alguien para explicarlo bien, porque de repente yo tengo una hija adolescente que me hace las consultas a mí y yo le puedo decir, son ladrones, por eso no lo quiero, pero me gustaría algo más parte de ustedes, que ustedes se puede decir que estudian la mente, no sé, disculpen lo poco a lo mejor en mi vocabulario, pero es el tema, o sea, el tema y el tema que se vive y el tema que yo vivo, o sea, del ciudadano común y corriente. Entonces yo para explicarles también a mis trabajadores, a los trabajadores y con la gente que converso. O sea, disculpen que me alargo mucho, pero para mí es importante eso. ¿En qué momento y cómo se puede reencantar? Y yo no creo que se pueda reencantar esto, pero ¿cómo uno podría reencantarse o...? Si en alguna parte en el mundo se sucedió esto y después se reencantó. O sea, eso es lo que... Y eso. Gracias.
Dos últimas preguntas. Tres.
Gracias. Hola. Quería pedirle si es que podría compartir con nosotros... la relevancia que usted le ha dado en su trabajo a la categoría de clase social como un dispositivo analítico y también como un dispositivo político, considerando sobre todo el contexto neoliberal y esta idea de la intensificación de una gestión autobiográfica y cómo eso ha ido acompañado de una deslegitimación de la categoría de clase social. Eso. Gracias.
mi pregunta proviene de una observación. También encontré muchas similitudes con respecto a lo que pasó en Chile, en particular en algunos lugares, por ejemplo, en ciudades como Lota u otras que eran industriales. Hay un hallazgo que a mí me pareció muy significativo y que es lo que motiva mi pregunta. En los años 80, en dictadura, cuando bueno, se cierran muchas industrias, el hombre pierde su sentido de masculinidad tradicional, ocurrió también que muchas mujeres, sobre todo en esos lugares, pero también en el Gran Santiago, se las tuvieron que arreglar para, digamos, ser los jefes de hogar y tener que financiar con trabajos temporales, uh-huh, qué sé yo, en fin. Uh-huh. En ese momento todo hacía pensar que la permanencia del hombre en la casa, forzada por la cesantía, iba a mejorar la convivencia. Pues ocurrió todo lo contrario. Hubo un alza sorprendente del maltrato y de la tensión conyugal. Y lo que recuerdo, que por lo menos en una investigación quedó muy nítido, es que en el caso de muchos de estos hombres, el hecho de que la mujer se las arreglara para traer un poco de dinero al hogar, sustituyéndolo a él en ese rol, era una amenaza. Y el último recurso, aunque fuera primitivo, inconsciente, que tenía el hombre, era golpear la mesa y golpear literalmente a la esposa. Por ejemplo, en muchos casos se tomaban el dinero. Digamos, tenían prácticas, qué sé yo, de alcoholismo, en fin, etcétera, que eran como una manera de reafirmar su identidad. Entonces, mi pregunta es, ¿allá se ha visto algo o se vio algo parecido a propósito de estos años también de postindustriales y de la crisis de la masculinidad que tú analizabas en tu exposición?
Bien, una última pregunta que estaba pedida tras la palabra y con eso ya devolvemos la palabra a Valerie y cerramos.
Gracias. Hi, thank you for your presentation. My question is very specific and it's about one aspect of your research, and particularly the research in the affective dimension. Uh-huh. Yeah? And I wonder if you can give some more details about your research in that area, because there is a lot of debate around the category itself, considering, for example, that we can find a lot of source, like, I don't know, Deleuze, Masumi, Claude, mm-hmm, but also Lacan, Laclau, mm-hmm, and others. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. Well, there are some wonderful questions. I'm not sure that I'm going to be able to do them all justice, and I thank you very much for them. Okay, so... The first question was about each country addressing their own neoliberal specificity. And the speaker asked, or at least this is what I've written down, what were the common grounds and the different contexts? Could we try to get together across these affected areas? Is there a common ground? I think people have started to talk in their questions, actually, about some issues that are in common. So I think this is one of the things that we're going to have to find out. What are the commonalities in terms of modes of governance, production of subjectivity, effective responses, and so forth? I think that is something that we need to do. But I think the questioner, if I've understood correctly, was also saying, can we use those commonalities to build something different? I can't remember who the questioner was. Yeah, did I get that right? Yes. And I think that is an important, a very, very important question. And one of the things I was, I suppose, trying to say in relation to this DIY or flat pack democracy is precisely to see it as an attempt to understand commonalities, those commonalities being
we have to only we can act for ourselves. Therefore, although it's an engagement with a parliamentary system and a system of elections, usually for local government, nevertheless, I can draw people's attention to a website. There's a very interesting website called DIY Democracy or Flatpak Democracy. Actually, I think it's called Flatpak Democracy. And there people are saying things like, I've never stood as a local councillor before. I'm just an ordinary person. But that sense of taking the opportunity to take some small action and forms of power, I think is really interesting, actually. And that we can't expect other people to speak for us. Now, I think you're asking for more than that. And I have to say that also in my wilder fantasies, I do imagine the possibility of working across some of these communities with people saying, well, we did this, you could organize like that. The people from the steel community going to work with, well, they are going to do this, actually, because the two communities I talked about, one in the ex-steel community and one in the market town, are going to get together and talk about different kinds of strategies. So, yes, I think that's possible. And if you're asking me, well, should we be doing this as a research project and not just looking at how neoliberalism works, then I think that was that's a fantastic suggestion. Thank you. I think it's really important. The next person asked about illiteracy and that maybe there wasn't such a thing as a class awareness. I'm not quite sure if I got the question clear, but is there a hidden ideological project that goes beyond survival? Well, okay. One of the things, a traditional, there is a very strong traditional class awareness within the communities in the South Wales valleys. It was one of the first, they had very radical Labour Party MPs, and now we're in Bevan, who was a founder of the National Health Service, came from the area. There are many, many famous left-wing politicians who came from these valleys. They have, they're traditionally very militant. And what happened, but I am talking about very one specific geographical area. You cannot generalize across all deindustrialized areas of the UK. But they felt that what happened was that they had traditionally supported the Labour Party, but when the Labour Party under Tony Blair took on neoliberalism, that's when massive amounts of people tore up their Labour Party membership cards and stopped engaging. That is the history of the move towards standing as independents, because in the case of this ex-steel community, they have a very clear engagement with a pre-1975 vision of Britain in relation to Europe and the possibilities of manufacture. They're very, very politically, they're able to talk very clearly about the political history and the political present and the political future that they want. But they do not see any
political party as offering them that. But that is not, that relates, and that's why I think the specificity is important. I don't think that that is the case in the same way in other deindustrialized communities, for example, in the north of England. Because although there is a very strong militant left tradition, it's not exactly the same tradition. So it's a question of, so yes, they have a project that goes beyond survival. Yes. But I think that it's important to understand that the project begins with survival and with the possibility of self-determination to bring in something that the people in those communities want. I this may be not correct on my part, but that's what I feel at the moment. And going on to the question that posed by the trade union leader, where you said that the political parties had also disappointed, and that I think you were saying, so I hope I've got this right, that that your trade union leaders no longer want to talk about political issues. Did I get that right? Okay, yeah. Gracias. because that would that I that is equally true.
It's more about the relation with political parties, not about political issues.
Ah, political parties. Okay.
Is there a disconnection with political parties?
Ah, okay. Well, no. It differs between trade unions in the UK. So some trade unions are still affiliated with the Labour Party. That is their, so they pay a levy to the Labour Party. But not all of them. It depends on the union. So some of them, yes, have disaffiliated from the Labour Party and do not pursue a political agenda in the same way. But you are asking me, when did this disconnect happen? And when did politicians detach from reality? Well, I think they detached from, sadly, they detached from reality quite a long time ago. But they certainly detached from the point of view of these people, they detached from reality at least in 1997. People were, which is when Tony Blair and Labour were elected on a neoliberal platform. Certainly, they were prepared to give the new Labour government a go because everybody hated Margaret Thatcher. But it did not take long before it was recognised that, you know, nothing would happen. But I want to answer your question in a more developed way, really, because I think there is a history of the left in Britain that relates not just to trade unions, but, and people have written, you know, there is some, beginning to be some writing about this, which actually looks at the history of the left from the post-war period onwards in Britain and the engagement with, first of all, the move to cultural Marxism, and then to, well, yes, to more cultural agendas and to agendas beyond Marxism. And actually, what this writing begins to chart is a
a sense of people being not addressed, not heard quite a long time ago, not engaged with quite a long time ago, certainly long before 1997. What the writing on this does is trace the way in which the right has listened, that the right has engaged with the senses of despair that are happening in these communities, and that the left, the left fell apart, but the left was not listening, and therefore there is call for a rethinking of the left in the UK and what that actually might mean. So again, you see, I think we're into a period where everything needs to be rethought. I also did some writing myself about, I wrote a paper called Of Dinosaurs and Divas, Is Class Still Relevant to Feminist Research? Where I also traced or began to trace a short history of what happens in relation to class and working class women across this period. And one of the things I pointed out, because I came from the post-war working class into the academy when there were very few people there. And there was a kind of radical project of individuality, of hippie trails, of going to Nepal, of being a project of the self, really, of being something different. And as somebody who then entered a highly paid work through the academy, I began to realize that all the people who did not be able to go into more highly paid work began to be not thought about or not talked about or engaged with politically by not just a traditional left, but also more countercultural movements that were not engaging with this life. And I think you see that also in Brexit, because you've got people who felt they could enter into an enticing world of consumption, global travel, think about themselves through the counterculture. But there was a huge number of people for whom that never happened. So I think that's also an issue that we need to engage with. And I think it's time for me to finish, but I don't know how to answer all these questions. But somebody said, yes, about social categories and class delegitimization of class. Well, yes, but I think that although work has transformed and traditional categories of class within the UK don't work in quite the same way, the work that I have done over many years looks more at engagement with subjectivities as a way of thinking about class. And I came to that really through not being as a working class woman, understood in a traditional classed way that related much more to male manual workers. So I think that again there is work which now in the UK which is rethinking how to think about class in these terms. And I can give some references later if people want it. I'm just going to finally, oh no, there are two more questions. In the 1980s, during the dictatorship, the speaker asked, when men were losing their masculinity and women had to do something to become the heads of the households. In the case of many I'm just trying to go through the question. Yes, you were talking about domestic violence. You were talking about domestic violence, and you were asking, was there a rise in domestic violence? Yes. Yes. There is certainly women have talked about that rise in domestic violence in these places. But again, I think one needs to understand this domestic violence within its context. There is a tendency to understand and engage with that domestic violence by pathologizing a masculinity that is seen as simply wrong. I think that it's absolutely crucial to understand the historical trajectory of the shifts in masculinity and what this, and femininity, and what this produces in order to fundamentally engage with that. I think any kind of psychologization that simply pathologizes is not in itself going to work. So again, I would ask for a more complex engagement. But yes, you're right, it's a similar kind of issue. And just finally, affect, and can I give details about a lot of debate between Deleuzians and Lacanians? Absolutely. And is the work on affect contested? Absolutely. But I think, and of course, it's a really important issue to think about relations of affect and relations of desire. I have found particularly helpful the work of some post-Lacanians, because many of the French post-Lacanians actually engage certain aspects of British object relations, particularly Winnicott and Bion, and they do so in quite different ways. And I think, you know, it's important to understand that Félix Guattari was also a Lacanian. And he was one of the people that starts to engage with that. So, and some people whose work I'm particularly fond of tries to rethink Lacan in a historical sense. So, again, I think there are many kinds of theoretical and methodological issues that are really important to think through. It's not that I have any, I've done a lot of work in relation to Lacan and also in relation to affect and Foucault. I'm quite eclectic, really. Again, I think all of these things are for us to think about and engage with. And I understand that there are many different traditions that are also, very well articulated in the UK, and I'm sure are articulated here both similarly and differently. It's about time for us to do this work together, I hope.
Bien, muchas gracias. Le damos un aplauso a Valerie.
Thank you.
Bien, agradecemos la presencia de todos ustedes y damos por concluida la conferencia y esperamos en los próximos meses, años, poder volver a tener más espacios de encuentro e intercambio con Valerie en el marco de este horizonte de trabajo conjunto que planteaba. Muchas gracias.